Hello, Radio Irish.
Hello.
Hello, Finbar.
Yeah, how is things, Sean?
How are you?
Good, good, Sean, and you?
Grand. How was your trip down to, where are you, Pennsylvania?
Yeah, we're in a place called Amber at the moment, outside Philadelphia. We had a gig here last year, which was very good, you know.
Well, we're delighted to welcome Finbar Furey to Radio Irish. How is the tour going, Finbar?
It's excellent at the moment, and the album is already getting some terrific write-ups, and everything is flying at the moment. And yesterday I found out my daughter, Anya, who's also just released an album, and they made her Best Female Vocalist of the Year in Chicago on the folk program, the Best Album. So it's flying, you know, Fury's everywhere, it's great.
Now, your new CD, Finbar, simply titled Finbar Furey, contains 12 haunting songs that really do move the heart. Talk to me, Finbar, about your songwriting. What types of stories inspire you to sit down and write a song? Or in other words, what gets the pen writing these days?
Just something like, I just finished a song now called Peace One Day in Time, you know? And it was something I read in the newspapers, you know, a few months ago. What happens, it's like, I put it into storage in my brain, I suppose, you know. And then something clicks it off. I really don't know how I write the stuff. I just sit down and it just comes out, you know. And, you know, I get an idea which way I have to take the song. Like, the song opens up, for instance, you know, Peace One Day in Time. It says, when young men die without reason why, the power that money can buy, young girls weep with a heart they will keep forever in tears and prayers. You know, so stuff like that. And it's an anti-war song, and it's just anti-violent. So it's just about the heartbreak of war, you know. Don't know where it comes out of. I just reading news articles, I suppose, and watching television and just saying, you know, and then just these words come out and put a song together. I don't really eat the way I do, you know. I don't really know. I've often sat down and listened to songs I've written like 10 years ago. And I say, how in the name of God did I write that, you know? Or did I write that, you know what I mean? Like, I don't know where it comes from. But it just comes. And I enjoy it.
Now, you officially began your solo career in 1993, I believe, after the group Davey Arthur and the Furey Brothers disbanded. What made you go solo, Finbar?
Well, Davey left the band. Davey was played the banjo, like the tenor banjo. I played the fife string. Davey plays the traddy stuff, you know, on the banjo. And I did all the Sweet 16 stuff on the fife string banjo. So Davey left in 1988. And the band, I think, by then was just, it was becoming a rut, you know. I mean, we were singing the same stuff every night after night after night, you know. And I had more music to play, and I decided to leave. And I'd had enough. I was 15 years, I was a lead singer with the band and front of the band, you know. And it was my wife who said to me, you've got to get your new music out there, you know. And I was losing my piping as well. I wasn't playing enough pipes with the band, you know. And I didn't have enough space on stage, because you had to share it with the brothers, you know. And so I decided to go on my own. And I haven't looked back. It's been great. And I had a great time with the band, too. I mean, we had our moments. We were wonderful. We rocked the world together. And to do that with your brothers, you know, was wonderful. But we all knew it was over, you know. It was just a matter of just, like, there was nobody writing any more music anymore, you know. And I still wanted to write and put music in there. And again, we were owned by these big agents, you know. Like, our lives were signed away for 2 or 3 years, and once the contract's finished, I left, you know. That was it.
Now, your family life and traveller traditions, Finbar, are deeply rooted in your music and songs. With your good self and your brothers, George, Eddie, and dearly departed brother Paul Furey, working on music together for decades. Paul being an accomplished accordion player. Paul sadly passed away in 2002, God rest his soul. How did Paul's passing affect you, Finbar?
Just like any brother would affect, you know. I mean, it doesn't matter. Your brother is your brother, you know. It's just love. As they say, blood is thicker than water, you know. And with me and him, we were as thick as thieves, the pair of us, you know. We grew up together. He sat beside me in school. We went to school together. We made our first Holy Communion together. We made our confirmation together. You know, he was only a year and a half younger than I, you know. And when we played on stage, he always sat on my right-hand side. Very... Everywhere we go, any photograph you ever see of the band, Paul sits right on beside me on my right side. And when he was in school, he sat on my right side. And it's just a piece of me, you know, just a big piece of me missing. That's all, you know.
Now, during your earlier years, Finbar, your father, Ted Furey, was playing the fiddle and is said to have taken yourself and your brothers with him when he performed on stage. Indeed, back in 1959, you all played with your father in your very first session at the famous O'Donoghue's Bar in Dublin, along with the Dubliners' founder, Ronnie Drew, God rest his soul. What springs to mind, Finbar, when you think back on those early years?
Well, I can picture Kieran Bourke, who used to be with the Dubliners too. I taught Kieran how to play the whistle when I was a very young kid. Kieran used to go up to the house, and he wanted to learn to play the tin whistle, so I taught him how to play it. And he got involved with my father then with the music, and then he said there's a pub called Donoghue's Pub, where there's a guy called John Malloy, who was an actor. John passed away as well, and John used to drink in there, and they needed a bit of music, so they brought, Kieran brought me and my father down. I was 11 years old at the time, and when I came through the door, the first person I met was John Malloy, and then a couple of nights later, Ronnie Drew came in, and Ronnie had just come back from Spain. He was teaching English, he was an English teacher in Spain. And he'd given his job up and he wanted to be a folk musician, which he always was. And the very first group that ever played in Donoghue's was my father, Ronnie Drew, and Kieran Bourke. And that was it, long before the Dubliners or the Furey Brothers or anybody else. Now it was about 1958. And that's 1957, 58. Donoghue's was officially then started, I suppose, in 1959. But we were playing music there since 58, you know, 57. But it all grew up there, you know. Luke Kelly was working in England at the time. Luke came back and Luke met up with Ronnie, and Ronnie met, you know, John Sheehan then happened to walk in one night, the fiddle player, and the Dubliners grew out of Donoghue's, you know. And we watched the boys take off. We were still kids, you know, and the lads were absolutely massive. And then people like the Clancy Brothers used to come in there for a drink then, and it sort of attracted all different musicians. And in the end, people like Robert Kennedy, you know, had actually a pint of Guinness in Donoghue's. Would you believe that, you know? And it just became a very, very famous pub, you know, even now. But we would have started it all off, yeah. My father would have, yeah. Incredible days.
Incredible indeed. And I think it's true to say, Finbar, that the travelling community in Ireland now, of which you are probably the most famous son, certainly the most famous family, the Pavi community has witnessed terrible bigotry and racism over the years from the so-called settled community. How difficult was it to smash that stereotype, Finbar, when it came to being taken seriously as a musical group, you know, back in the early years of the Furey Brothers? It must have been a bit difficult, no?
Well, in a way, yeah. I mean, we grew up more apartheid and stuff like that, you know, and racism and all that. But, like, my mother and father were very clever people, you know. My father said, it's their arrogance. He says, it's not your, you know, their arrogance. And to be right, you know, I don't even go in there, because I had some great friends who they grew up in Ballyfermot, you know, and I never had any trouble, you know, maybe the odd bunch up at school or something like that, you know. But, like, nothing absolutely major, you know. But like, when we had three number one albums down in South Africa during the time when Nelson Mandela was locked up over there, you know, during the apartheid, and they invited us down to South Africa and we wouldn't go, and that's the way we paid it back, you know. We didn't play for any countries or racism involved, you know. Our music is for, doesn't matter what color you are, what race you are, it's folk music, and it means music for the people, folk music, you know. We had our fair share of, we stood our ground when people would, we never grew up on the road. I mean, we grew up in a house, you know, and we were educated and we went to school, you know. But it never bothered me, really. I just walk away from people when they do that, because they're just stupid people, silly people, you know. I mean, God gave us all two arms and two legs, the same as everybody else. The only thing he gave us different was imagination. And we all got different imaginations. And if this guy wants to use his imagination that way, go for it. I'd like to use my imagination in other ways, you know. So, I mean, it's their loss, you know. I mean, I think they lose out a lot in life, you know. And I think they do regret it at the end of their days, you know. But, I mean, racism has got, it's everywhere. It's all over the world. It's horrible.